Celebrating and giving thanks to God. And we've shared messages of praise and hope. We talked about, you don't know what this praise cost me. We've talked from Psalms, and we've talked from the scriptures that point toward praise. So Isaiah 61, beginning at verse 1, simply says, "The Spirit of the Sovereign Lord is on me. Because he's anointed me, to preach good news to the poor. He sent me to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim freedom for the captives, and release from darkness for the prisoners. To proclaim," one version says, "the acceptable year," but to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor and the day of vengeance of our God. To comfort all who mourn, to provide for those who grieve in Zion. To bestow on them a crown of beauty instead of ashes. The oil of gladness instead of mourning. A garment of praise instead of a spirit of despair." You may be seated. Just a few moments with this thought in mind. I'm gonna put a praise. An hour is late, but I really want to take my time and lay this foundation. Isaiah is writing here, and I want to give you the backdrop against what he's saying here. He's talking about how God is going to restore, in essence, his glory. He is going to restore joy. He's going to restore his people. But if you look at this entire book of Isaiah, they say that the book of Isaiah is really two books. They call it First and Second Isaiah. It's one book, but the first 39 books talk about God's wrath. For the first 39 chapters of Isaiah, he's talking to the people of Jerusalem about the price that they're going to have to pay for the sin in their lives. For the first 39 chapters, his message is repent, for the kingdom of God cometh. He's talking about how poorly they have lived and the consequence of their actions. He's talking about how judgment is going to come. He's speaking about the wrath of God. He's talking about the cruel kings Ahaz and Manasseh and all that they have put the people of Jerusalem through. And yet the prophet Isaiah is not afraid that even in the midst of his unpopular message, he's telling them, you got to do what's right. But then there's the thing what they call Second Isaiah, and that's the last 27 chapters of Isaiah. And it's in these last 27 chapters that God gives Isaiah a word that there's going to be hope for the people of Jerusalem. And so for the next 27 chapters, he's talking about how God is going to restore the kingdom of God. He's talking about how God is going to set the captives free, how he's going to deliver those whose hearts have been downtrodden. He's talking about that there's going to be a Messiah that's coming. And when he talks about the Messiah, he says he's going to be a sovereign Lord and a suffering servant. That's the verbiage that he uses throughout Isaiah when he begins to talk about the Messiah that's going to come. You remember, we're going to talk a little bit about it. You'll hear about it next month, how that a king is going to come, and the weight of the world will be on his shoulders. You'll call him Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Prince of Peace. He talks about, he begins to prophesy about how it's all going to change when the Messiah arrives, and that there's going to be hope that we did not have before because the Messiah is coming, that all that we have lost and all that we were concerned about will be restored because the Messiah is coming. And of course, the Messiah, again, is going to be a sovereign Lord, but he uses his verbiage, a suffering servant. Now, the reality is that they will not come to pass. They won't fully understand that until the New Testament comes, because they can only hear and imagine what that's like, because they have, but they won't know what it's actually like until the New Testament, when the Messiah does come. They won't know what it means for him to be a suffering servant until he does come and dies the cruel death of the cross. They won't know what it's like for him to be sovereign Lord until the resurrected day of resurrection, when he conquers death, hell, and the grave. But Isaiah's preaching about it now. He said that there's going to come a day. They said one is coming. He said, and when he comes, he's able to do all that he's talking about right here. He said he's able to restore joy that's been lost. He's able to heal in men broken hearts. It's right here in the text. And so that's the backdrop against where we're talking and we're looking at Isaiah right here. And so we meet him in Isaiah chapter 61. And in Isaiah chapter 61, Isaiah said, listen, he says, I'm coming to share with you what my assignment as the prophet is. And Isaiah has been known and has been labeled as the greatest prophet of the Old Testament. In fact, he's quoted over 50 times in the New Testament, and his prophecies were so on point. He was prophesying, he wasn't prophesying, and so they understood that they called him one of the greatest prophets of all time. And in chapter 61 is where it comes to fruition, where all that he's been preaching about, he says, listen, he says, I've come for this appointed time, and God has called me, watch this, to preach good news in bad times to my people. He said, that's what God has called me to do. He's called me to preach the good news, even in bad times, to my people. And I don't know about you, but that's good news, because God has come that we might have life and life more abundantly, and he's going to use Isaiah to give us the hope of that good news, the euangelion, the good news. That's the hope that we have in the Word of God. And so he came to preach the good news. The text says he came to preach to the poor. But now understand something, that's not the best interpretation. The best translation is that he's come for the meek. Let me tell you, the meek in spirit, because he's not just talking about poor people. He's not just talking about those who are on financial hard times. He's not just talking about those who spend all their money on Black Friday, who spend all their money in Christmas and buy all of what they want and come January and beg for what they need. He's not talking about people who have been financially irresponsible. That's not who he's talking about. Though some people may find themselves poor, that's not just who he's talking to. He's also talking to those who are not just financially disabled. He's talking to those whose spirit is poor. Because there are some people who have plenty of money in the bank, but their spirit is poor. He came to preach not just to those who are low in class and in society, but those who have money but have a low spirit. Because you know that, especially those who can give and give and serve and give and love and serve and give some more and love and serve. And you have given all that you know to give, and you have given out, but you have not replenished yourself. And because you have not replenished yourself, you find yourself low in spirit. And then there are those who they're not serving, they're not loving, they're not giving anything to anybody. And because of that alone, your spirit is poor. And understand, Isaiah says, I came to give hope to all. He says, I did not come to preach. I don't have a respecter of persons. He said, I have come to preach all. He says, here's the good news. The good news that I came to preach about is able to change everybody's life. He says, so I came to preach the good news. But he said, I did not just come to preach the good news. He said, I also came to talk about one who can bind up the brokenhearted. Have I got a witness here? He said, somebody, and now anytime you have this many people in the room, you know, you're guaranteed that there's somebody with a broken heart. There's somebody who's going through something that has their hearts heavy. And so he says, I came to bind the broken heart. What does that word mean? I'm glad you asked. Has anybody ever broken a plate? A broken a vase, a broken a cup, a glass, or something. You, anybody besides me, I'm the only one guilty of that? All right. Okay, it's about 10 of y'all now. All right. So the 10 of us who have broken glass know that when the glass hit the ground, it did what? It shattered. Well, in the Hebrew, this is the word, this is the picture of what Isaiah is trying to paint. He's trying to say that because when I broke the glass and when you broke the glass, what did you do? You got a dustpan and you swept it in the dustpan and you put it in the trash. I mean, because if it shattered, there was nothing that I or you could do with it. In fact, once it shatters, our hope is gone for using that again. It is good for nothing but the trash. But what Isaiah is saying is he came for those whose hearts have been shattered. He came for those whose hearts have been broken. He came for those who have experienced brokenheartedness. In fact, that your heart has been shattered. He's able to bind up your broken pieces and mend them back together again. And that's what Isaiah said. He says the good news is, he says, I've come to preach about one. I've come to preach the good news that even that those who are poor or poor in spirit, those who are broke or even broke in, he said, I serve a God. He said, and he's able to take our broken pieces, no, our shattered pieces, and he's able to take those shattered pieces and bind them back together again and restore joy. That's the kind of God that we're talking about. He said, I didn't just come to preach the good news. He said, and I did not just come to set you, I did not just come to bind up your brokenhearted. He said, but I also came to set the captives free. I'm still right here in the text. He says, I came to set the captives free. Now understand, he said, and release darkness from the prisoners. Now that's at least two different kind of prisoners. Because they are under the hand and rule of the Babylonians. And so Cyrus had just sent out a decree that set them free. And so they were just coming from underneath the oppressive, hard ruling thumb. And Cyrus now that has set a decree that all the prisoners are to be let loose. And so there are some who were literally behind bars. And he was saying, now is your another chance. Not just your second chance, because all of us have used up our second chance a long time ago. Now we're on another and another chance. And he said, so open up the prison doors and everybody's going to get another chance. So who's in that another chance crowd? He said, there are some of you who are guilty of crimes. He said, there are some of you who are guilty. You did it and you're guilty. He said, but here's the good news. I'm going to give you another chance. He said, but not only those who have served some time, he said, there are some of you who have been set free. You're walking around free, but you're locked up as prisoners under the cloud of darkness. I wish I had a witness here. In other words, you are living your life free but bound. Yes. There's nothing worse than being handcuffed with toilet tissue. It's the picture of being wrapped up with toilet tissue and staying in the same place for a long time, talking about you handcuffed. No, you're not. You choose to stay where you are. And that's what happens because too many of us are not bound by prison bars. We're bound in our minds. And he said, I'm coming to release the captives, not just to set them free physically, but mentally and spiritually. Because too many times we stay and we are where we are, not because we can't do more, but because we won't allow ourselves to. Sometimes we have allowed our personal sin to keep us in darkness. I wish I had a witness here. There are sometimes when it's not just our sin, but it's the shame from our sin that keeps us in darkness. God would move us forward, and God would do something significant in our lives. God would change our lives. God would move us to the
the next level, but we're still where we are, not just because of the sin, but because of the shame.
Yeah.
Sometimes we allow our past to hang on too long. I wish I had a wing.
Yes.
Do you know how they catch monkeys? In Africa, they said they put nuts in a jar that's big enough for the monkey to stick his hand in.
Okay.
But once he grabs a handful of nuts, he can't pull his hand out.
Uh-huh.
And so they catch the monkey because the monkey will hold on and be caught in the same place simply because he won't. I see we got some smart monkeys in here. Understand something. Yo, if we just had monkey sense, we know that we had to let our past go, because too many times we are being held captive and we're being held in the same place doing the same thing over and over again. Not because God, not because something is holding us, but our minds won't let it go. And so we're in the same place. But Isaiah, say, if you will, comes to say, I didn't just come to preach the good news of the gospel. He said, I didn't just come to tell you about these good news in bad times. I didn't just come to tell you about one who can bind up your broken pieces and mend your heart. He didn't just tell you, he said, I also came to tell you how I can set you free. But also, he said, I want you to know that it's your time. I wish I had a witness in here. He said, I want you to know that this is the year of your favor.
Yes.
He says, because the year and the time that you decide to let your mind be set free,
yes,
the moment that you decide to let God free your mind, the day that you decide to let God set your heart free and set your mind free, the day that you decide to walk in your another chance, he said, in that day, that begins the year of your favor.
Yes.
That will be the time that God will begin to open up doors for you that had always been closed in your face. He said, that will be the time that you'll experience the grace of God like you've never experienced the grace of God before. It's in that time when you understand what God is trying to do in your life and with you and through you. He said, it's in that moment that the favor of the Lord, watch this, he said, it's going to be a favorable year. And because some of us have been through so much, some of us have seen some dark days, some of us have seen some hard times, some of us have been broke and broken, some of us have been hurt and let down and disappointed by life, and some of us have been so hurt and backed up against the wall that we just can't even see our way through. In fact, the reality is we feel like throwing in the towel. We feel like it's just a kind of old McDonald tactic. You just wake up, you know, here is sin, here is this issue, there are issues everywhere, an issue. You wake up, you get the kids, you sit in the school, you go to work, you come home, you cook, you get them in bed. You wake up tomorrow, you do some hair, you sit in the school, you go to work, you go back to bed, you wake up. It is the same old cycle, time and time again. You don't see your money growing, you don't see progress in life, you don't see where God is taking your life. You start to feel hopeless, you start to feel pointless. God said, Zay came to let you know that the day that you see it differently, the day that you set your mind free, the day that you decide that you're going to do something different, the day you're going to be something different, the day you're going to let go of your past, let go of your merry-go-round, and decide to be on God's way. He said, that's going to be the year of favor. He said, all that you've been praying for is going to come to pass. All that you've been fasting for is going to come to pass. All that you've been hoping for is going to come to pass. He said, but you've got to get on God's plan and get off the merry-go-round of being the same. He said, God wants to do it. He said, but I didn't just come to preach that to you. He said, I didn't just come to tell you the good news in these bad times. He said, I didn't just come to tell you that God will bind up your shattered pieces and put you back together. And he said, I didn't just come to tell you that God wants to set your mind free. He said, I didn't just come to tell you about the year of favor on your life. He said, I also came to tell you that he's going to deal with your haters. Oh, here's how they put it in the word. He said, vengeance will be mine. He said, there's going to be a day of wrath. He said, everybody who came against you, everybody who was speaking against you, everybody who was talking crazy to you at work, everybody who passed over you for promotions, every time that you got looked over, every time you were disrespected, every time you were stabbed in your back, every time you were lied on, every time you was mistreated, you ain't got to cuss them out. You ain't got to fight them. You ain't got to stand. You ain't got to cut their tires. And created for you, and I know today that you don't have to wait for 1717. You can walk in celebrate what began in 16. Because the day that you make up your mind that it's going to be different is the day that your year will be different. Make up your mind and decide that I want to be set free. That's the day that God will set your mind free. You can start walking in your freedom today. You don't have to wait till we scream Happy New Year. You can say to me Happy New Year right now. Happy New 16. Until on our way to 17, understand something. But Zay has more good news. He didn't just come to tell us the good news in these bad times. He didn't just come to let us know that God can take the shattered pieces of our life and pull them back together. He didn't just come to tell you that he's going to set your mind free. He didn't just come to let you know that this is going to be your year. And he didn't just come to tell you about how he's going to take care of vengeance. To understand so the day of vengeance is the, when Christ comes back. That's not, because see, some of us want God to do something right now. Right now, we want God to get them right now. That's what we pray, God, get them. And we want God to strike them dead right now. Get them, Lord. We want, but God says, it's coming. He said, it's coming. Because watch this, somebody said that about you. Aren't you glad God didn't strike you down when you was wrong? Come on. Hold on, let me try to get it. When you was wrong, when you was in sin, when you did somebody wrong, you was glad that God didn't strike you down right then. He didn't answer their prayers. But aren't you glad? But he didn't just come to tell you about the vengeance that day is coming. God also came to say, he says, I came to walk with you through your grief. Wow. Let me try again. He said, I came to comfort you. He's this right here in the text. He talked about how comfort those who mourn and to provide for those who are grieving. Because here's our reality. Sometimes we've lost some along the way. I mean, that's our reality, especially in this Thanksgiving season. We sat down with our families to give thanks, and we said grace, and sometimes it got a little rough, and some of us got teary-eyed, and it got misty, and it got a little rough because we started thinking about who wasn't at the table anymore. We started thinking about grandmothers and grandfathers and godparents, and sometimes mothers and fathers and brothers and sisters that the Lord has called on home, and that thing got a little rough for us. And I know every now and then it gets rough for me. I'm human being, but I want you to understand something that God said, I came to comfort you. He said, I came because I know you're going to have some rough days. He said, I came because, he said, some of y'all are grieving. He said, I came to provide for those of you who are grieving. He said, I came to comfort those of you who are mourning. He said, because I know that even though you've made up your mind to be set free, you're still thinking about somebody who didn't make it to the freedom level that you made it to. Yes. That everybody that you graduated from high school with, some of your best friends have gone on to be with the Lord. Yes. Some of your closest cousins, they were your best home or your best girlfriend. They were cousins. They were better than family. They were friends and better than friends. They were family. It was all together. I mean, y'all were both and God let them go on home. And you wanted the same, you wanted it to be great for the both of you. You wanted to experience it together. God knows that that's going to cause you to mourn. God knows you're going to grieve that process. He said, but then guess what? I did not come to leave you alone. He said, I came to walk with you.
Yes.
He said, I came to hold your hand through that process. I came because I know you lost some. He said, but your loss is not in vain. Even though they're coming to be with me, he said, I'm coming to be with you.
Yes.
He said, so I've sent myself. I've come down through 40 and 2. He said, I came to comfort you.
Yeah.
I came because I want you to know that I'm willing to walk this thing out with you. And it's all right to cry. It's all right to shed tears. He said, but just know that I'm here to comfort you. He said, but I didn't just come to comfort you. And I didn't just come to preach to you. And I didn't just come to do. He said, but I also came to crown you. What do you mean? What do you mean, Zay? Zay, what do you mean, crown me? Because back in the day, they wanted to show and display humiliation. They would sacrifice a red heifer, and they would spread the ash over the person who they were trying to humiliate. And so that's what they would put on their head. They would spread the ashes on their head and on their face, and that would be a sign and symbol of humiliation. And so what he says, God, Zay says, no, he said, I'm coming with one. He said, who's not coming to humiliate you. In fact, for instead of and he's going to give you a crown of beauty for those ugly ashes. For everything that you've gone through that has shamed you. For everything that you've gone through in your life that you're not proud of. For everything that you're allowing to keep you right where you are and stay in the same situation. He says, I'm giving you something. He said, I'm going to crown you. And I don't know about you, but that's good news to me. That God thought enough to crown me. That he thought enough that instead of humiliating me, he crowned me. He said, everything that you have gone through, he said, you need to know that you're a king's kid. He said, if you're a king's kid, that means you're heir to the throne. He said, and that means, he said, I want you to wear a crown. He said, I'm going to give you a crown. I didn't come to humiliate you. I didn't come to expose you. I came to crown you because I want you to know that you're my child. He said, but I didn't just come to crown you. He said, while I'm still dealing with your head, he said, let me anoint your head. He said, because it's through my anointing. He said, well, and understand something. When God anoints us, when he allows his oil to run down our head, he's trying to tell us, you built for this. Yeah. He's saying, you're not just somebody. You were made for this. He said, this is your time to shine. This is your moment. I created you for this moment. You were born to do this. You were born to succeed. You were born to make it. And that's the good news about our God. God sent Zay to let us know that he didn't just come to preach good news to us in some bad times, even though we are experiencing some bad times. He said, but I didn't just come to tell them that you're preaching in a bad time. He said, I also came to let you know that we're going to bind up the things that could have kept you down. He said, but we didn't just come to bind up those things. He said, I also came to set you free. He said, but I didn't just come to set you free. He said, I also want you to know that this is your time. He said, if you do ever get your mind free, he said, you're going to walk in favor. He said, everything's going to be all right. He said, but I didn't just come that you might walk in favor. I came that you might know that vengeance is mine. He said, I need you to know that you don't have to do anything irrational. You don't have to act out of character. All you have to do is be who I created you to be. And I'm going to do something so significant in your life that you will be blessed and you'll see that nobody else can do the very thing that I have called and created you to do. You don't have to take vengeance into your own hand. But I didn't just come to tell you about vengeance. He said, I came to comfort you. He said, I came not just to comfort you, but I came to crown you. He said, because I want you to know that you were built for this. He said, I don't want you, just want you to think that you were built for this because I came to crown you. He says, I also want you to know that I came to cover you.
Yes.
Let me try it again. I'm through. But he came, he said, I came to cover you.
Yeah.
Preacher, what do you mean you came to cover me? Well, when we talk about covering, he says, I came to give you a garment of praise.
Right.
He says, because I want you to understand that as I have given you this garment of praise, he said, everything that you have been through, every sorrow, every hurt, every time that your heart was broken, every time that you were let down, every time that you were disappointed, he said, I came to cover you. He said, I came to cover all of what you have been through. He said, and the way I'm going to cover it is with praise. Let me try it again. One thing I've learned, and I didn't say this last time, but this is what I was trying to get to, that when we give God praise, even people don't know what you've been through. Let me try it again. Because I don't care how heavy your heart is when you walk in here. When you start to give God praise, when you start to tell God, thank you, not only does it confuse us, it confuses the devil. Because he doesn't have access to your soul and to your spirit, so he doesn't know what's going on, but he can just watch what you're doing. And so he sees you waving your hands, and he knows what you come from. And he knows what you have been going through. But when you get in God's house and begin to give God praise, and when you begin to tell God thank you, when you begin to wave your hands, and when you begin to pat your feet, when you begin to stand up and tell the Lord, you know what, you sure been good to me. And people don't understand that it helps you to not look like what you've been through. It's God's way of covering us. And God says, I'm going to give you the garment of praise. He said, you got to put praise on, man. And you got to wear praise. Let me tell you what it means to wear praise. When you wear praise, that means you wear it wherever you go. That means you'll walk through the grocery store and give him thanks. You'll walk through Black Friday mall sales and give him thanks. You'll walk back on your job on tomorrow. even think. You'll go back into school, to your class, even to the teacher that you always say don't like you, and you'll still give that because it does not matter. Because he says, if you wear praise, people can't tell what you're going through. He says, so this is what I have given you as a weapon. He said, if you begin to give me praise, I wish I had a witness here. Come here, young man. Come here. I know your hands hurt, but watch this. Let me tell you something. Whenever you give God praise, praise does not always look the same. Come stand right here. Somebody line up behind me. Praise can look differently depending on where you are. And on that straight line. Watch this. Begin to clap your hands. Because she's giving God some praise. Hallelujah. She's clapping and giving God praise. Kennedy, just wave your hand. Wave your good hand right here, baby. Just wave your hand and tell God. Continue to keep clapping. I want you to start jumping up and down. Start jumping up and down. That's her way of giving God praise. Start spinning around in a circle. Don't keep yourself busy. Because if you fall through that wall, you're going straight through there, all right? Here's what you want to do. I want you to do like this. Like you running in place. Come on, do it. Come on, clap your hands. Come on, wave. Hallelujah. Come on, jump. Come on. Jump. Come on, spin.
Let's go.